rain.
Here in
the and we received by the in March 2016, we received a statement from the city saying that they were going to that they now had possession of tide lands. The state had deeded the tide lands to the city to the people that was in the city limits and to the borough to the people that was in the borough. The new lease called for a retroactive payment back through 2014, I believe. Bear with me here because my numbers might not be good. But anyway, that the city did not have anybody working or couldn't find anybody at that time to take care of this portion of this lease. So now the city's come back and told us they want us to pay the $2,000+ retroactively while we were paying our quarterly payment on the lease, as well as the new lease could be increased to 50% more than what we're paying at the present time. It's going to make roasting the hot dog and storing your skin pretty skinny. I would like to see what the possibilities would be of the city doing the same thing that the borough did with this exact situation. They reduced these numbers back considerably. I'm a trustee of a couple pieces of property that's in the borough that have tide lands. One of them, we're saying the annual fee was about $1,600 a year. The borough reduced that back to around $500. Now, I don't know whether they did that through the appraisal method or what. I would hope that we could be on the same footing with the borough with our situation. I believe there's only two pieces of tide lands that are under residential in the city limits, if I'm not mistaken. Is that correct? Yes. I'm told that you can't deed the tide lands to me or sell them to me. You don't want the state title is not allowed that. But obviously, the borough was able to do something to bring the rate down to something that's livable. But this is really spending really fast.
Have you talked to the Spanish yet, Ron? Excuse me, talked to Carl?
Well, I've talked to Carl about it, yes.
What's the management?
Mr. Chairman, these are the leases that were transferred from the state to the city several years ago.
Remember,
the existing leases are the renewal date. The language within the lease calls for either 50% increase in the annual rent, or the leaseholder has the option of going out and getting an appraisal, the cost of which could be equal to or more than the increase of 50% in the appraisal. Those are the terms that we have to work with. We have some correction and modification by the city council. Mr. Porter and I, as well as public works staff, have been discussing this issue over the last few weeks. We encourage him to come to address the council tonight. If the council has a desire to look at action schedule, like the General Assembly did some time ago, we can certainly do that. But right now, staff is limited by the existing terms of the lease, absent of the direction of the council.
Thank you. We'll make sure Ron will bring it up so that we can discuss it and see if we want to make an action.
Brian, you know, if the leases that were reduced through the borough, were they residential leases also?
No, or they were commercial. No, I don't know. Okay. You don't know.
I'll make sure we address it at the council.
Okay. Thank you. Do you have any questions?
Can I just ask why they're raising the wider the city some years ago had petitioned the state management authority of a number of tide land leases that were of interest to it at that time. We went through a process with the state transferred the leases to the city. They actually transferred the lease agreements. The lease agreements that are coming up for renewal, the language that the state had negotiated was upon the renewal date, the lease payment was increased by 50% for the holder of the lease to go out to get a fair market appraisal of the time for this lease. And that was really up to the holder of the lease. That's what we've been advising everybody who has leases coming due. Our supporter brought his concerns to me. We talked with the public works staff and then going back and forth. At one time, I did think that we had the authority to transfer the lease. There's something in the patent language that bars us from doing that. If that's what the council wants us to explore with the state, we certainly can do that. I'm not getting a potential exposure for just the residential uses. I don't know if that's a possibility or not, but it's something we can pursue.
Well, I think if we bring it up to the next council meeting so we get an update. I mean, I remember doing this, but I can't remember what's going on. So at least we'll know where we're at.
Yeah, Ron, what's the lease under the state and what would it be for the state increased 50%? Do you remember what it was on your property?
Our quarterly payment had been, I believe, $351 per quarter. And I did a quick deal on the back of my head, come up to about $550 a quarter. However, I'd like to make a point again that we have been paying our lease payment quarterly forever. Now, because the city or whoever was responsible did not have anybody in place to do this when it should have been done, they're wanting us to come now back and they want to bill us for the $2,000 that should have been in place with the new document.
Even if I could just address that, Mr. Mayor, again, that was the existing language in the leases that we inherited from the state. That language was in there that if the lease became due and payable and it wasn't processed, the lease holder would then be on the hook for that one, which wasn't billed under new terms and provisions at the time of the year. These leases, unfortunately, got set aside when Morgan Berry went to the borough. He was personally responsible for those and didn't bring attention.
Yeah. So let's get an agenda so we can get the update for the council and the tool that you're doing. Thanks, Ron. Thank you. Marianne, did you want to add something?
Well, just to mention that our lease is not due until 2021, and we were.
Come on up to the podium.
Two parts is going to be a component that will review best practices from around the world for ferry systems to kind of deal with the managerial component of the system and how it's run. And it'll be a second, larger, and much more labor-intensive part that will deal with the operations. This is a very important project. As we can probably all agree, the Marine Highway System is broken in its current form. We're facing an uphill battle with budget cuts and the kind of unfortunate fact that we've lost a lot of political clout in coastal Alaska. And so, you know, we have an uphill battle with the Marine Highway System and things are not working in their current state. So this is a very important project, something that I definitely think Ketchikan should support in particular. Ketchikan, I would argue, has probably more to lose than many of the other communities that are impacted by the Marine Highway System. First of all, we have the offices here. That's about 70 employees of the Marine Highway System that live here in Ketchikan. I think it's about 300 when you total all the people that actually work on the boats themselves. Besides that, of course, the shipyard here, that's a huge piece of our economy. Another 250 workers that get the bread and butter of their salaries from doing repairs on the Marine Highway System and, of course, the new build. And then, of course, there's all the other businesses that are impacted by the Marine Highway System, whether they be hotels, bars, restaurants, you know, all the tourists that come through here on the ferry system. And then even just what I'm learning, being more involved in the transportation industry, how much the Marine Highway System is a piece of the overall transportation picture for Southeast Alaska. A lot of what the Marine Highway System does greatly impacts our seafood processors, our fishermen. I mean, it really touches every aspect of our community and all the communities through coastal Alaska, but I think in particular Ketchikan. So I really encourage you to support the recommendation that the mayor and the manager brought before you. And also, I would strongly suggest that you consider matching the Ketchikan Gateway Borough's contribution of $10,000. I think that's a reasonable number. This project has a lot of support. We recently signed a memorandum of understanding with the governor's office, and the governor has committed $250,000 from DOT to help fund this project. To me, that really says it all. And to this point, when I last checked a few days ago, I think Southeast Conference had raised almost half of its goal of $100,000 from private businesses, municipalities, etc. So, to me, the outpouring of support really speaks for itself and shows that this is a good project. Personally, I'm super excited about it. In September, at the Petersburg Conference, I'll take over as president of the Southeast Conference, and I would really love to be able to talk about how much Ketchikan has contributed to this project. And I also want to make a personal commitment to each and every one of you that as the project moves along, that I can be a direct contact for any questions or concerns you have about where the project's going or an update. I just want to be available for that. So I think this is huge. I think this is probably the most important thing Southeast Conference has done since they kicked the Marine Highway System off over 50 years ago. So I would just, you know, like I said, I would suggest that you match the Ketchikan Gateway Borough's contribution, and I appreciate the motion being included in the packet tonight.
Any questions for Chelsea? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Anybody else want to address the council that didn't sign up? Seeing that, we'll move on into the consent agenda. I have a couple additions. Under seven, new business 7A, I have 2-3. The whole on wall, two things. And then 7B, 1 and B5. We already did B1. No, it's a good consent.
Okay. So 7B, 1 and 5.
And 7A, 2 and 3. Anybody have anything?
No.
Yes?
Yeah, I'd like to ask that we hold the discussion on 5A, 2, and 5B.
Yeah. We'll put it on there, but we'll just take the thing going on maybe.
Minutes of the regular City Council meeting on June 16, 2016, budget transfer, general government case review, employee identification badges, budget transfer, reimbursement, and general fund to support enterprise fund. Amendment number one to contract number 1632, design and inspection of Berth 3 emergency repairs, Moffitt and Nichols, accepting the procurement of SCADA maintenance equipment with competitive implementation requirements of the Test Manager's Code, Open Systems International Inc. Request for a variance for nighttime inspections, BAM LLC. Change order number two, final to contract 1522-4, Holland Wall Harbor Replacement Project, Western Dock and Bridge LLC. Resolution 162631, amending the 2016 general government budget to provide supplemental appropriations for Harbor Department, $160,000. Resolution 162632, recognizing John Clevenger for his 30 years of service at City Public Utilities, Ketchikan Public Utilities, and Ordinance 1822, amending the Ketchikan Municipal Code, Chapter 1112, Telecommunications Servicing Rights for Free.
All right, if there's no other questions other than A2 and B2, let's call the roll on those.
For employees to have badges that they're wearing all the time? Is the idea that the employees have badges just in case they need to produce them? What's the, I didn't get a real sense of why it's necessary. I really didn't get a real sense of what that would do either.
We should first start with how, as a discussion about employees and employees are entering residential premises or on residential property. Employees and that issue had information for that purposes. That involved an issue of the employees' best practices. We have a number of people from the public who are in all of our buildings, and people are not identified by name or position. Members of the public are given the staff. And we have reached an inclusion that after looking at what other municipalities do, there would be inclusion to have some type of badge.
Anybody else have questions? Call the roll on that, please.
On the surface, I agree with this 100%. I see the reason. But it's such a blanket thing. And there's no restrictions. There's got to be a strong will to change. You know, we look at this occasionally, then, or we just get totally ignore our residents as much as we can. So I guess that's my one. Isn't there some very mechanism?
Councilmember Kaiser's time is well taken. I think the language would be to have approval or authorization of the discretion. The first thing, they want to do past the 10 o'clock time frame that would require the approval of the
first. And are we talking about after midnight? I know, but I mean, I think a word past midnight.
Director Marshallson. Yes, it's possible they could work after midnight. However, it's more likely they're going to do a very early start. So first light start on the days where they have to make water main crossings across Mill Street.
So it would be in the morning?
Most likely it would be a very early morning start, yes.
Thank you. Anybody else? So that would be done, in advance of the actual excavation. So you typically see the saw cut out, a few hundred feet. And that's done normal working hours. But the excavation, the breaking of the concrete, that's normally done with breaking of the concrete or paving of the road surface is normally done with the excavation. So they won't break all that up because we're talking about the road crossings. So then a couple things happen. The paving gets recompacted or it gets broken up so much down so fast and they don't get to it right away. So we really prefer that they just not break up the pavement until they're really ready to get to it.
Any other questions? Thank you, sir. Call the roll, please.
Harris. Tyson.
Yes.
Jameson.
Yes.
Kessler.
Yes.
Zinge.
Yes.
Coos.
Yes.
Page.
Yes.
And that passes 7. Nothing brings us down to new business 781, budget transfer last to the Highway System Reform Project. Do we have a motion?
Your Honor, the City Council of Coordination of Southeast Compton and not truly appropriate by the City Council in support of Southeast Compton's Alaska Marine Highway System Reform Project and authorize a budget transfer in a comparable amount from appropriated reserves of the General Fund of the City Council's 2016. Community Promotions account number 610-01.
Good and second. What amount do you guys want to get?
$10,000.
Anybody else? One motion, please. Carl, we have to just let you know that we'll make sure we approve this motion since it's
not here.
We're giving direction to 10,000. Call the roll, please.
Tyson?
Yes.
Sigurdsson?
Yes.
Pfeiffer?
Yes.
Zenge?
Yes.
Coos?
Yes.
Gage?
Yes.
Harris?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, that passes 7-0. That brings us down to 784, marijuana cultivation license application. Do we have a motion? There's the two options.
Your Honor, I'm proposing to do this because that's the manager with judges between option 1 and 2.
You bet.
Sir, my understanding of the motion for alternative motion number 1 is that the council approves the application as presented. Alternative motion number 2 is the condition of the current satisfactory review by the city of Fire Marshal.
Now, my question was on, I guess let's have a motion first.
Your Honor,
go ahead.
The City Council approves the marijuana cultivation facility license application for Rainforest Cannabis Cultivation contingent upon satisfactory review of the city get and Fire Marshal.
Moved in second. My question I have for all is this the time of review? I mean, does he have some designs and everything all in and everything? I didn't know if this is the time for the Fire Marshal to.
Mr. Reynolds came from the city clerk. I had not seen any of the paperwork on this, so I'm not in a position to respond.
I'm going to ask the owner to come up and tell us where he thinks he's at with this. Jason?
You know what?
I know you probably weren't prepared.
I'd like to point out, first of all, I am not hearing impaired, so
okay.
I want to ask you to repeat yourself and apologize.
First, identify yourself. I guess my question for you is, where do you believe you're at with the Fire Marshal's review of your facility?
So the Fire Marshal review, currently in the process of working with Matt Alderson at the Public Works Department with the building program, and I've given some preliminary information to Matt, and he's come back with a lot of questions of our engineering drawings and our designs and whatnot. I'm in the process of answering his questions, making some changes to the designs that he's recommending. And once Public Works gets the information that they require, then I believe that's when they share that information with Life Safety and the Fire Marshal. And so at this point in the process, I'm working with the Public Works Department and the building permit. Like I said, as I understand it, that's the first step. And then the Fire Marshal will get the packet of information off as I understand it, has already been completed. Jonathan's been working on the tree list for a while. He said there's some additional conditions they put on the zoning permits, and one of those is the actual, you know, award of the license. And so you can't complete the zoning permit until you get the license awarded to you by the state. And so we've gone through and approved the public drawings and everything, and the zoning permits have been approved. I've answered the questions that would be made part of the conditions of the permit, but I think the final straw or the final thing there is getting the license actually awarded by the state. And the state has actually approved the application with delegation. With delegation means that you have to get all your local permitting, all your local issues resolved before they will actually give you the license. So they looked at the application, they said it follows the regulations, they approve the designs, you'll approve the application with delegation, go back to your local government, start working through the process with local government, where you can put that permit, you can fire marshal approval, and come back to us and schedule an inspection of your facility.
So that's the mechanics of it. Have you guys figured out the testing part of this?
So I've been contacted by an applicant in Juneau that is looking to, they're after just submitted an application to start a testing facility in Juneau. You still have to get your product to Juneau to be tested. It's a lot harder than trying to get it to Anchorage to be tested. I know it's a tricky question, and how it's going to be transported there. There's been statements by the ferry system that they allow you to take an ounce of marijuana on board and they wouldn't try to, you know, prosecute you or anything. I know that last year one is actually reconsidering the policy statewide for marijuana transportation as well. And it's my understanding that in Oregon, Alaska Airline actually allows transportation of samples across the strait to cover across the strait to transport the facilities. So I'm hoping that Alaska Airlines will come to that conclusion of the state of Alaska with not all of the ferry system.
Thank you.
Thanks. Anybody else? Thank you very much, Jason. Any other questions, Council? Yeah.
Probably for management, are we premature in approving something like this until we have more information? We're approving something we, I mean, he's done his work, but we've still got some engineering stuff as far as stuff. And,
but the contingent has been done. Some contingent has been done.
The motion says that they have to complete it to the satisfaction of the fire marshal before they can move forward.
Could I speak to that for one more moment? So you have to schedule a state facility inspection with the state because they want to make sure everything that you've submitted to them matches your facility design. You can't schedule a inspection from the state until the facility is built. You can't go to the facility until you have local building permits and fire marshal approval. So it's part of the process. It's a longer process. So it's absolutely necessary to get that fire marshal approval before you can move forward with getting your facility built and before you can schedule the state inspection before they award the license.
Anybody else?
Thank you.
Call the roll.
Summer on the motion. Okay.
Go with the motion. Okay, so we have to
Stevenson?
Yes.
Kiefer?
Yes.
Zinging?
Yes.
Who's? Gage?
Yes.
Harris?
Yes.
Isom?
Yes.
Okay, that has the 6-1. Thank you, Jason. That brings us down to new business 7B2 resolution 162630, amending the 2016 Hitch County Public Utilities Operating Capital Budget and provide a supplemental appropriation to the division in the amount of $20.4 million. Do we have a motion?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Bob.
2016 Kitch Camp Public Utilities operating capital budget to provide a supplemental appropriation for the water division in the amount of $1,400,000 in salary and benefits.
Second. Moved and seconded. Bob, you have anything?
No, I just moving forward with the project. Thank you.
Charles, are we going to start?
And this localization and starting preliminary activities as we speak.
Great. Anybody else? Call the roll.
Pfeiffer?
Yes.
Zinni?
Yes.
Coos?
Yes.
Gage?
Yes.
Harris?
Smith?
Tyson?
Yes.
Davidson?
Yes.
Okay, that passes 7-0. That brings us down to 7B3, Ordinance 68-23, amending the Kitch Camp Municipal Code, Section 312-58A12, to delete the competitive bidding exemption for Kitch Miniature Internet, such an exemption for wireless phone service, wireless phones, license, and related accessories. First read. Do you have a motion?
Your Honor, I move City Council approving first reading Ordinance Number 16-18-23, amending Subsection 12 of the KMC Section 3.12.050A to delete the competitive bidding exemption for the Ketchikan Shipyard and such an exemption for wireless phone devices, related accessories, and establish an effective date.
Second. Moved and seconded. Bob?
Yeah, my understanding is what this is going to do is allow us to use the Verizon service that would get away from all the other stuff. And I believe our attorney felt that just remapping any existing wireless
phone. Excellent. Carl, what was the little shipyard thing in there for? I can't even remember.
It's in regards to the deletion of archaic language and believing that it dates back to the time when the city actually operated the shipyard.
Gotcha. Thank you. Anybody else? Call the roll.
Zinni?
Yes.
Booth?
Okay.
Gage?
Yes.
Harris?
Yes.
Tyson?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Pfeiffer?
Yes.
Okay, so 7-0, that brings us down to 7B4, Civil Land Release Agreement, Contract 1425 for a water main replacement project in deconstruction. Do we have a motion? Go ahead.
I move the City Council approve the settlement release agreement between the City of Kitchikan and Paul Hamilton to the business P&T Construction regarding contract number 14-35 for water main replacement and direct general manager to execute the agreement on behalf of the City Council.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Stranger, anybody want to add anything?
No, it's free.
Anybody else?
Yes.
Call the roll.
Coos?
Yes.
Gage?
Yes.
Harris?
Yes.
Tyson?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Pfeiffer?
Yes.
Zane?
Yes.
That passes 7-0. That brings us down to approval vouchers daily use for $1,220.55. We have a motion.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Call the roll.
Gage?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Harris? Tyson?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Pfeiffer?
Yes.
Zinni?
Yes.
Coos? Yes.
That has passed the 7-0. That brings us to manager's report. Carl?
We have a number of items in the package for various stories, especially in the facility in the States. The matter as it stands, she has indicated that the council is on fire. She can battle the move of the council to discuss the state's perspective on career. There's probably any questions that council members have. Try to arrange for that meeting.
Anything else?
Oh, a couple more. Note for the record that Berth 3 is back in service. Again, I just want to express my appreciation to Chairman Moffitt and Rico and the Fort Harbor's director, Sue Corporal, and his staff. I think they really did an outstanding job. I'm sure all of you who are here for the 4th and the parade noticed that the Thundering Wings Eagle is back on its perch. A number of us got together very early, July 12th in the morning. I'd like to show thanks to Dave Martin, the assistant city manager, public works director, Mark Wilson, acting street supervisor, Tom Gaffney, senior maintenance technician, Curtis Bruce, and maintenance technicians, Kerry Charles, Willie Galloway, Jim Nall, and Brian Craig. These people gave up a good portion of the work to make that happen, and I think it really reflects probably the difference too. In the hospital was dedicated. The hospital was dedicated on the 24th. We don't know before, but I do want to give short kudos out to Matt Brown. We put down a lot. We were giving it a lurch. Matt really stepped forward and took that project on as his own. In fact, it was completed on schedule. This is a really low credit to him. And I just want to again thank him. And lastly, relative to the resolution you passed tonight, I just want to again extend my personal appreciation to Mr. Flanker. I have worked for John since 1999. We've done a lot of projects. And I know water doesn't often get the attention that you have to come out of it, but it's equally as important. And John has done very well. I can be you and the community as a whole. I just want to commend him for his efforts. So, John, thank you. That's all I got.
Thank you. Any questions on anything for the council?
Carl, I see that we're going to give a portion of the parking lot down in Shawn Bar for the Water Street construction, providing some parking for, I think, the contractor and the Alaska. Is that just daytime parking, or is there going to be displaced residential parking? I know there's some residents that park in that area due to the street area and that type of stuff.
Councilor Michelson, I don't know if it's restricted to daytime parking, but I will find out.
Anybody else? City clerk's file.
Then, Your Honor.
City attorney's file.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Future agenda items.
One of the things that as we move into some new businesses that may have a potential power draw within the community, I think we need to look at our tariffs or practices in regards to interruptible services, off-peak services, demand services, things like that. There will be a large pellet manufacturing and just a displacement of the existing one that we have, but we will also have some cultivation. I know in certain areas in lower 48, they've had issues with power draw, transformers and lines and all that kind of stuff. I just wanted to make sure we had policy to deal with that.
Do you want that up in that?
Well, I guess I'll give that to your management. They'll probably take a look at that and see what our options may be.
Anybody else on future agenda items?
Do we know where we're at on the taxi cab information?
I think we're going to go back to us once this week's are up. Correct?
I understand that the sale is putting out another
request. I have two things. Pastor Justin from the Gateway Baptist Church, I don't know if you guys know who he is, he hands out flyers down there by the Eagle, down by the Visitors Bureau on the sidewalk. And he is really pushing to be able to hand them out down there on the walkway at. You can call that a promenade. And because he has people coming, kids come in during the summer at different times for 3 or 4 days and they hand out little tracts. Right now, the court policy is to have no one on there. And he'd like the council to address that and see if you guys wanted to change that policy so. They could deal with a section down there. And I told him I'd bring it to the council. I hate to, I mean, he's passionate about this, and I understand that, and he thinks, you know, he's willing to fight this in court. So I didn't know if you guys wanted to address that and talk to him and see if he wanted to do any changes or not, but I wanted to bring this to the council. Would you guys like to talk about that next week? The present policy is we don't let anybody on the court do that, correct?
The council's past direction is the courts consider the working court, and we don't let solicitation or those type of activities on the court. If you let one,
So I will let you know the council was not interested in reviewing that. Also, I've gotten a request from a citizen that's been, I guess, I hope that he says he's been talking to you guys about possibly coming up with a name for the Visitors Bureau building. I told him I'd bring that up to you guys and see if there's four hands, at least take it to the naming committee, and we can see if we want to do anything or anything. Is there any interest in that?
What is the process? Because this individual wants a specific name for it.
Yes.
Actually, I agree with you. That's like, I know sometimes you get a situation where once you give it to the board, you then choose the
correct.
So I guess are we basically saying give it to the board the name after this, or are we just opening up the name?
We can open up the name like we did on the hospital. If you had certain people would have, you know, I've wanted to have enough Dr. Anthus in the committee, then we can come to no consensus, so we just ended up. So, if you guys want to go through the process, I just need 4 hours.
I see no reason to name that building.
Are there 4 hands interested in moving forward or not? I'll say, hey, and see if they have any ideas of what they'd like to name that building. We can take the ideas. The committee comes up. If they want to do it, they'll come up with something to pass on the council. The last one, we couldn't come up with anything, so nothing came to the council.
So we don't have say in the
name? Yes.
Okay.
Yes, the council has sponsored.
Yeah, that's what I was trying to figure out.
Yes.
So
it comes back to
the council always has a plan.
So, do you want to go through the process or not? I just need to know if there's 4 items.
Yes.
1, 2, 3. Okay, we'll take care of that. Get back to you later. All right, that's all I had. Mayor and Council comments, Nick?
Yeah, just one, and looking at the KBB report, I noticed that the gross revenue is on the itemized thing that there are in that report for all the things that we sell in town. From 2014 to 2015 went down by 10%. And the reason I'm saying this is I don't know what the trend is this year, but we need to be cautious with our money because the trend is not upward. That's all I
have. Thanks,
Katie. I just want to congratulate John. I know that sometimes this, your job's not easy. I've received a lot of calls in the last couple of weeks about a hockey ordinance. And I guess I'd kind of like to report on that if possible and how that's working, because there's been a lot of complaints that I fielded, and I'm just wondering if it's really doing what we intended it to do. And that's all I have.
Kelly?
I've been down in the box for a while, actually, and I've been seeing quite a bit of the abuse of the rules. And I have recorded it. I don't know if there's a way to, like, get people to call it in, but I watched them over my turns. I yelled at the guy to leave it alone because he would not let it pass, and it was down on the sawmill section. And I noticed it a lot in that area.
Yeah, this is my first year organizing the parade, and I just want to say Kesh Ken is amazing. I thought the 4th of July here was really, I am excited to stay here for the 4th of July, and I worked from 6:30 in the morning until 3:30 at night because I was on the crew to help map out the booths, and then I was on the cleanup crew until 3:30 at night. And even though I worked, I still had a blast at what I did, and I had 8 volunteers for the parade monitoring and for the banner holders, and none of those 8 showed up. And so I had people step in at the last minute to carry the banners and to monitor the parade. And the biggest volunteers was the Ketchikan Volunteer Rescue Squad. And they are just amazing. And they're becoming older now. And they're trying to groom the younger
seniors.
Exactly. So if anyone's interested in getting on that crew, I would suggest that they're a great group of diverse people.
Thank you very much. That's fun.
Yeah, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody that makes the 4th of July in this community happen. There's a lot of individuals that go out of their way to provide the services that we do on the 4th. That, you know, it's all kind of stuff. You know, people are ordering their stuff for the prizes and the food and organizing different events and things. So the 4th was, the weather cooperated with the pandemic. It was nice to have you with it. I personally like to congratulate John. I worked with John when I was working on the city, and he's always been very cooperative and has put forth incredible effort to meet the community needs. And I think that his understanding of our water system and his diligent work on it has continued to provide safe drinking water in the community. I'd like to thank him.
Oh, yes, also congratulations to John. Even when I wasn't on the council, I was just sending it to Burn. When I called him, he asked the question, he always answered it. Yeah, and kudos to everyone who's been before. This is the first story for about 15 years and a half in the marsh. So I've been lots of radio, so it was really nice. It's an interesting reaction to the downtown business. We closed it so we could watch the parade. And the parade people came up and looked over and go, why is it open? Because we're in the parade. Oh. We're in here. And it was, do you do this every year? Yes, we have a parade every year. Oh. We all kind of go, we passed it and some of you go, oh, wait, this is a town. We are just there to provide platforms for jewelry to run. So it was nice to see that reaction.
Hey, Dan.
I don't want to
start
a
Well, I want to say thanks to John, too. If we go back to Florida. It's always great looking at him. I got a couple things. The parade was great, Bob. I saw you guys filling it everywhere. I always enjoy the 4th of July, and it's always great. And Julie, you did a great job, and I thank you. And sorry, I didn't lead in to the next floor. Hockey. I think we're on the right road. Everybody's learning, and we have a person out there now giving out tickets and understanding what's going on. I mean, it's learning the process. It's just a, we'll review at the end of the season. I mean, it's been going smooth the last few days, I believe. I haven't talked to Dave, but nobody's called me, so I'm hopeful. So,
Can I get a ticket book?
What else did I have? Radio. Does anybody want to do the radio tomorrow? Radio publicity.
Yeah.
Lee, did you have something else? You asked
a comment about the hockey game. You made a comment that you've seen somebody have it, and I think it's important. Was that from a booth, or was that from
a booth? No, it wasn't from a booth. It was a business.
Okay, because some of the, at least one of the booths is probably pretty good at that, too, and I see that pretty regularly. So we'll have to watch them at some point in time here. It's usually just one booth that I know of that is as
All right.
I'd like to also thank us all for your participation and providing.
I have no other business. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.